Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Let me start with today's topic. I'm to give you a brief overview about the pollution-free reactions. From the last 2 weeks or so, we are going through different topics which were meant to make you people understand about the involvement of the pollutions generated by the different chemical reactions and their environment related issues. And in order to cater those environmental issues, people have tried to make reactions a sort of pollution free reactions. In that aspect, there are a few categories of the reactions which are supposed to be sort of pollution free reactions. In fact, there are virtually no type of reaction which is supposed to be a pollution-free reaction. However, there are types of reactions which could be regarded as the reactions with minimum ecotoxicological effects, mean those create a less amount of pollutants, they are less hazardous to the environment. But virtually they can't be 100% green, they can't be 100% eco-friendly. As far as the chemical reactions are concerned, they are supposed to be creating some sort of environmental impacts, environmental issues. They can't be 100% pollution-free reactions. Let me start with the same phrase, that is pollution free reactions, means such reactions without pollution. Such reaction won't produce any pollution. Or you may call such reactions which create no ecotoxicological effect. Toxicological issues. A reaction could be a pollution free when it creates no pollution or it creates no ecotoxicological effect, no ecotoxicological issue, or they are the reactions with zero emissions. Zero emission, very important technical terms. Zero emissions means no removal of any byproducts, solvents, or any hazardous material from the reaction into the environment. No production, no removal, no movement from the reaction mixture into the environment. Such reactions are supposed to be reactions with zero emissions, and they are supposed to be the pollution free reactions. However, in actual sense, virtually there are no such reactions. Virtually there are no such reactions mean in chemistry, in chemical kinetics, in chemical transformations, no reactions are such which can be the zero emissions, which cannot produce any emissions, no reactions at all. There are no ideal circumstances. Ideally, there are no reactions which are pollution free. However, attempts have been made to make reactants with less pollutants, less hazardous for the environment. So let me explain why reactions cause pollutions, why chemical reactions. Cause pollution. Why and how? You may say how chemical reactions cause pollution. Initially, we should look into why they cause pollution and then why we need to reduce or eliminate that pollution. So, we need to know how the reactions actually produce pollutions, you know. This needs to be looked into in the beginning. We have an idea, a chemical reaction involves, number one, reactants. You know, different reactants, they are supposed to react together, so some sort of reaction could happen. The reaction between two reactants, more than two reactants, will produce some sort of product, the product of some our desired product, you know, our desired molecule, whatever our desired as per the choice. You know, if we are working in agrochemical industry, we are working in medicinal industry, or we are working in a lab at the graduate, undergraduate levels. So, it, as per our requirement, we react different reactants together. They do react with each other under reaction conditions to produce products. So, initially reactants are involved. Those reactants, they could be hazardous in nature. So if the reactants are hazardous in nature, definitely they are going to produce negative impacts on the environment. They will produce bad impacts on ecosystem. They will be ecotoxicants. They will act as a toxicants, you know. So reactants, being hazardous in nature, they cause pollutions. So this is one of the aspects, that the chemical reactions can cause pollution. Why? Number one aspect, due to the hazardous nature of the reactants, they can cause pollution. Number two, for reactions, we use solvents. Organic solvents for organic reactions. Yes, the usage of solvents in different amounts, which are supposed to be discarded, removed from the reaction mixture at the end of the reaction in order to purify the products, definitely they are going to enter into the environment. So this, they can be the reason number two, they can be the cause of the pollution. So a chemical reaction can be a pollution, can cause pollution. Number one, either due to the hazardous nature of the reactants. If they're hazardous in nature, then yeah, they can have a negative impact on the environment, for the ecotoxicology, for the living organisms, for the microorganisms. Secondly, the solvents which we use for the running of the reactions, they could produce negative effects for the ecosystems. So it's a condition, fact number two, which makes reactions as pollution causing. Okay, fact number three, use of catalysts, auxiliaries, We have an idea in general for speeding up of the reactions, for better yieldings. We use different catalysts. Those catalysts could be organic in nature. They could be different sort of complexes, especially nowadays, complexes of heavy metals like copper, palladium, nickel. They are used as catalysts for different sort of reactions. So such complexes, which could be in the form of salts, you know, or some other catalysts in organic in nature, they could cause negative impact for the environment. So they could be pollution causing as well. So the reaction can be pollution causing, either due to the hazardous nature of the reactants, number one reason, or number second, the involvement of the solvent for a reaction. If that reaction is some sort of an organic, variety of organic solvents are available, they have a different sort of hazardous nature, so they could cause pollution as well. Thirdly, the use of catalysts, as I've explained, nowadays complexes of palladium, nickel, copper and other heavy metals are frequently employed in chemical transformations. So at the end, when such compounds do enter into the environment, definitely they are going to cause pollutions. Auxiliary chemicals, sometimes during the reactions, at the start, during the reaction, even at the end, we need to maintain the pHs, we need to increase, we need to reduce, or we need to increase the pHs of the reaction media, or sometimes for the you know, purifications systems. The involvement of acids and bases in that aspects, they are called auxiliary chemicals, the chemicals which we need to accelerate, to just to boost up the product formation, or to boost the efficiency of the catalyst. They are called the auxiliary chemicals. Definitely there are also some sort of inorganic salts, or sometimes other complexes, sometimes of organic compounds. So definitely at the end of the reaction, they are going to produce enter into the ecosystem, so causing bad impacts on the environment. So they are supposed to be pollution causing entities. So 3-4 reasons are there why the chemical transformation, chemical reactions are pollution causing. They are polluting the environment. That's why we are at the moment trying to find alternative reactions which are supposed to be pollution free, with zero emissions, emission free, mean nothing will come out from the reaction to move into the environment. Nothing will come, no emission. Okay, so such are supposed to be the pollution free, but virtually they are not that easy. There are many examples, such examples are known, which are 100% pollution free reactions. Going into the detail in order to give you a bit sort of an insight, first I'm trying to stress why the chemical transformations, chemical reactions are pollution causing. They could be, as I've just explained, due to the involvement of the reactants, or the involvement of solvents, or the involvement of the auxiliary chemicals. Number four, again, use of solvents for purification of product. Once the reactants have reacted inside the flask, the reaction has been run using different solvent, few catalysts has been involved, and we had to use certain auxiliary chemicals as well. Even at the end, when the reaction has been completed, we have the product in the flask along with the other entities. We need to purify the product. We want to get the product. all of the flasks, but at the same time the flasks do carry solvents, the remnants of the reactants as well as catalysts or maybe some other auxiliary chemicals. You need to purify. Again, how you can purify? Yes, if the reaction is an organic reaction, so we have an idea the product is supposed to be an organic product. So an organic product could be purified by using organic solvents. You may employ dichloromethane, ethyl acetate, diethyl ethers, any other available solvent as per the chemistry of the product, you know. So those could be involved. Again, the solvents are being involved. Usually we use those solvents 3 to 4 times. We introduce those solvents into the separatory funnel so that the maximum amount of product should get in, dissolved into it. We purify, we add solvent into the separatory funnel once, shake it well, then you just secrete, lose the secrete, drop by drop you get the separate the two layers, then you try to purify the react products with the organic solvent by dissolving it at least in an organic solvent in suitable amount, but that amount should be applied 3 times at least. So those solvents are going to be moved into the environment at the end, because once they have been used for the extraction of the product, the solvents will carry the organic product in it. We want to get the product only, so we need to evaporate the solvent. Dichloromethane, ethyl acetate, diethyl ether, or whatever it is, we need to evaporate that into the environment, either by simple evaporation or by using RotaVap. We evaporate those, we discard the solvent, or we just condense those into the other flasks in the RotaVap, and even then we discard into the containers which is supposed to eventually move into the environment. So this is how those solvents could be hazardous for the environment as well. So this is how I can show you why the chemical reactions are supposed to be the pollution creating, pollution causing. Yeah, the reactants, the nature of the reactants, or the nature of the solvents which we will apply as a reaction media, or the nature of the catalyst, or the nature of the auxiliary chemicals, and finally the nature of the solvents which are supposed to be used for the extraction of the product. So if, let's say, we have done a sort of a reaction where reactants are hazardous in nature, the solvent has been used, a sort of any organic solvents, every organic solvent is supposed to be hazardous in one way or the other. Similarly, some sort of catalyst has been used, some sort of auxiliary chemicals have been used, then the separation is supposed to be there at the end. So, 4 steps. Each step involves the use of hazardous material. Reactant, solvent, catalyst, again solvent for extraction. So, each step involves the use of pollution creating entities, molecules, solvents. So as a whole, even if at the end if we receive the product and in a very high yield that could be suitable in economical way, that could be possible that your reaction is high yielding due to the use of organic solvent as a reaction media, due to the use of a catalyst. Yes, then the purification step at the end has been very well managed by the use of excess amount of organic solvent as an extraction medium. So all these factors will enhance the working efficiency. Means your yield will be enhanced. Maybe you will be achieving more than 95% reaction yield. But each and every step has involved some sort of hazardous, nature's entities, so the reactions are supposed to be pollution causing non-eco-friendly, non-green reactions. So this is how the chemical reactions in chemistry, they are creating problems for the environment. They are in fact creating pollution issues, ecotoxicological issues. Ecotoxicological issues means anything which is going is hazardous in nature, moving from the reaction into the environment at the end. Maybe it is toxic and for the fish, for the microorganisms, for the plants, for the vegetations, even for the human beings. So this is how they are called ecotoxicants or toxicants simply. So all these factors make chemical reactions pollution creating, non-eco-friendly, having a negative impact on the environment. Keeping all these things in view, with the passage of time, people got awareness about the pollution and the impact of the chemicals on the human health, and the impact on the environment. They have demanded to make the reactions pollution free. They should be green, they should be eco-friendly. They said the reactions can be made eco-friendly either by using non-hazardous reactants. Mean you should use such reactants which are non-hazardous for the environment. If one does so, the reaction could become eco-friendly, pollution-free. Or let's say they are eco-friendly in nature, but still we need to use the solvents. The reactants are eco-friendly, non-hazardous. Virtually this is also very uncommon, you know. Most of the reactants, as they are organic in nature, they are supposed to be with negative impacts on the environment. Let's say suppose for a while, if the reactants are going to be non-hazardous, even then you need to involve the solvent for the reactions. That issue will remain. Okay, then people came up, okay, use the reactants which are super friendly, super eco-friendly, they're very much green nature. Then they said, okay, don't use the solvents, please remove the solvent, don't use the solvent, run the reaction without the organic solvents. Then such reaction can be pollution free, not 100% pollution free. Secondly, they said, okay, do involve such reactants which are more reactive to each other without the involvement of the catalyst. If we avoid the use of catalyst, then we can make the reactant react with each other at a faster pace under such condition when they are reactive to each other. Let's say one carries electron drawing groups, the others are carrying electron donating group. So in situ generation of charges make them react together at a faster pace without the involvement of any catalyst. It's a one theory. It's a one side of the mind that it could be done such way. Similarly, they said we don't need to purify the reactants, our products at the end. We can move on into the next step without purification. So if we do so, we will not be using the solvent for purifications. So means we will making no pollution for the environment, as no solvents are being used for reactions. Then those reactions can become pollution free reactions. As I've told you, it's a myth, you know, the pollution free. They can't be pollution free, but let's say for a while they can be made pollution free. Now I'm just recapitulating for you guys. The reactions can have negative impacts on the environment due to these 3-4 different factors: reactants, the nature of the reactants, the use of the solvents, the use of the catalyst, and then the use of the solvents for the purification purposes. So this is how the organic reactions, or even the any reactions are of reactions in chemistry, they can be pollution causing. Okay, they can be producing emissions into the environment at the end. So in order to make reactions pollution free in order to tackle these issues which make chemical reactions hazardous for the environment. People came up with novel ideas to make chemical reactions greener, eco-friendly and pollution-free, and that very aspect I've given you a detailed comprehension. I'm just trying to relate them today. Let's say people came up, they said we can do one pot reaction, use of single flask, do as many reactant steps of the reaction as possible. 2, 3, 4 different steps can be used in the same flask. Use of the same flask mean use of the same solvent, mean 3, 4 different steps are being performed in single solvent, so use of solvent has been minimized, not eliminated 100%. So such reaction can be not pollution free. In general, they are called pollution free reaction. They are supposed to be called, you know, our people do think so, but in fact they become eco-friendly to some extent as they have reduced the use of the solvents, have not eliminated. Okay, then afterwards people came up with the idea that reactions in aqueous media, yes, this was also a big solution to this problem. The use of the solvent creates pollution issues, environmental issues. People came up with the idea that we should not use solvents, organic solvent for reactions. We can use water because water is not that hazardous. Water is eco-friendly, it's pollution-free, it can't be a problematic. So they came up with the idea of reactions in aqueous media. So use of water can make a reaction eco-friendly. Just again, I'm trying to convey, it has replaced the use of the solvent. Maybe you still need to use the catalyst. Maybe you still need to use the auxiliaries. Yes, maybe you need to use solvent at the end for the purification. So the reaction will not be virtually pollution-free because the other entities are still involved. However, only the reaction media has been minimized, has been eliminated, so reaction will become eco-friendly, but it will not be 100% pollution free, okay, because the other elements, other factors still involved. Similarly, the people came up with another idea. Solvent-free reactions. People said we should not use water as well because at the end of the reaction, the water, which is not hazardous itself in nature, but during the reaction it can dissolve few of the catalyst, auxiliary chemicals, some of the reactants, some of the products. So then that water moves into the environment, it creates problems, it has some negative impacts. So virtually it will not be 100% pollution free reaction. Still there is an involvement of certain water as a media which can take few of the compounds into the environment. So that was not 100% free as well, eco-friendly, bit greener, not pollution free. Then they came up with an idea, solvent free. They said no use of solvent, no water as well, because there won't be water, means solvent there has been replaced with water. Then catalyst, auxiliary chemicals will not move with water into the environment because there is no water, solvent free, no solvent has been used, no organic solvent, no water. It's a solvent free, only reactants have been mixed together. Maybe again we need to use the catalysts. Even in the solvent free reaction, we need to use the catalyst, and also we need to use the solvents at the end for the purification of the product. So the use of solvent free reactions will make it again a bit greener and eco-friendly reaction, but we have not eliminated the use of these two bodies. Still they are to be involved in the reactions. So again, they are not 100% pollution free. They are not reactions with zero emission, not with zero emissions. So virtually not pollution free. Yes, it has reduced the use of solvents, organic solvents, even the aqueous solvents, water. So it means the water has shifted towards greenery, it has become eco-friendly. So these are the few of the approaches which has been opted to make reaction pollution free, reaction with less pollutants, less hazardous in nature, due to the involvement of the one pot reactions, reactions in aqueous media and solvent free reactions. The all categories have reduced the pollution causing tendency of the chemical reactions, chemical transformations, so have made them eco-friendly, greener reaction. But even then they are not pollution free. Virtually there is no pollution free reaction can be in 100% on ground, you know, because at any step you will have some sort of hazardous entity involved in the reaction. So they can be eco-friendly, they can be green, but cannot be 100% pollution free reaction. So it is at the end my view that you would have got now the idea why we need pollution free reactions, why the reactions cause pollution, why they cause bad impact, negative impacts of the environment, and then how they cause those negative impacts of the environment, then how we can eliminate or reduce the negative impacts of the environment. And you would have got an insight now that we cannot make all reactions or even any reaction 100% pollution free reaction because of the involvement of so many chemical entities at each and every step. So hope you got my message about the pollution free reactions, zero emissions, why reactions are causing pollutions, why we are looking for pollution free reactions. So if you have any questions, do ask me in putting your question in comment area, or you may approach me via WhatsApp or email. I will be happy to respond at my earliest convenience. So please go through the other reaction lectures on the topics. One pot reaction I've explained in a different lecture. I've also explained reactions in aqueous media. I've given a detailed lecture on solvent free reactions. Today I'm just trying to mush them all to give you the picture, what is the importance of these bodies, why we need, because we want to eliminate the hazardous nature of these bodies. We put these ones up. Even then, the introduction of these gentle developments has not served up to the 100%. So hope you got the message. Thank you very much. I hope it will enhance your knowledge about the pollution free or the reaction with zero emission. Thank you very much. Assalam.